tardes, and I bring you greetings from the Himalayas. In the Himalayas, we say Julay. So, Julay to all of you. Yes, I'll be sharing with you how in the Himalayas we are using simple high school science to solve complex problems, challenges like climate change adaptation, and in the process, engaging young people, students, and the community in general. But before I go to more of this story, let me share with you some images of Ladakh, play with some images to show how similar we are, even if we are so far away. So you'll see here Ladakh, up north of India. It's a high mountain desert in the rain shadow of the Himalayas. And life here is possible mainly because our ancestors learned the way of channelizing glacial meltwaters to flatlands in the desert and irrigate. And if you look closer, even though it looks lifeless, villages like this is where we live. And coming towards, in the Andes, towards Chile, it made me feel really at home. So let me play with some pictures. This is not in Ladakh, but in the Andes, as I flew in. But this is in Ladakh. Huh? You can see how closely similar they are. And this is in the Atacama Desert here. And this one is in Ladakh. So this is the Pangong Lake in the high altitude deserts of Ladakh. So this is how I feel at home here. In these otherwise inhospitable looking mountains, people have not only survived, but a whole civilization has thrived with its own distinct lifestyle, culture, music, dance, literature, spirituality, and so on. But yes, like the native people in the Andes, we are a microscopic minority of indigenous people in the Himalayas. In a huge subcontinent like India, we are very tiny. And therefore, being a minority is a problem, especially for our children. So 30 years ago, when I was doing my engineering, I saw the education system was like this. Only 5% every year used to clear their 10th grade examinations, which are like the passport for future education, employment, progress, and so on. 95% would fail. And I could see that it was because the education system that was brought from big cities didn't make any sense to the mountains, nor did the language. And yet, teachers who would come from the plains, big cities, wouldn't understand that, and instead they would often blame the students themselves for being dumb, stupid, and some of them would tell them that you don't have enough oxygen in the air, you can never do well. When I finished my engineering, I went back to my place and started a movement to change this system. We questioned, how can 95% fail? And together with the community and the government, which is supposed to run the schools, and many civil society organizations, we launched this movement called Operation New Hope to make education meaningful for the mountains. And very soon, in the next 10 years, the school results changed from 5 to 75, at least proving that it was not oxygen in the air. Yeah? But for those who still failed, which is not small, at 25%, we started a special school, a different school, and that is what I'll take you towards in this journey of using innovation to solve mountain people's problems. So because these students were not learning the way they were being taught, we thought of teaching them the way they learn. In other words, more engaged, more practical, application-based learning of everything. So, to utilize and channelize all the energy that young teenagers have, and which they are often, you know, blamed for creating problems, we wanted to channelize it, and what better than building the school with them and running the school with them rather than for them. So we went to a complete desert in the middle of nowhere in 94 and camped there, started building the school with mud, designed together with the students, and by 99 we had built a school that was very different in many ways. To begin with, this school, the criteria of admission is not your ranking and your marks, but that you have failed. And here, it's not just the young who learn, but it is also meant for the grown-ups to learn how to live on this earth lightly, even if comfortably, in harmony with nature. So the whole school is solar-powered. There is no other grid connection. It's off-grid and zero energy, built with mud, natural material that you find right under your feet, powered by the sun right over your head. And the school is run by the students themselves. They form a government for 2 months and run it like a little country, which prepares them for real life. And they give responsibilities to the students, or they take, execute, and report in the next parliament in 2 months. And the responsibilities they take are not mock responsibilities, they are serious. For example, some would take care of the cows and all the milk, but at the same time they would apply things like statistics from their mathematics to track the productivity of the cows during summer, winter, and so on. Those who produce organic green vegetables would not only use mathematics, but also learn economics by selling their product to the kitchen and learning profit, loss, and so on. Similarly, the power plant teaches them how physics can be used in actually making life comfortable. Innovations revolve around themes of earth, sun, ice, fire in our context, and we use the chapter on heat from high school science to build buildings that are passive solar heated and can be plus 15 degrees when it is minus 15 outside. It's just simple convection of hot air in the greenhouse that goes into the rooms and is trapped when the students close the windows in the evening, and there they see convection coming alive and making them comfortable. Conduction through the south walls and radiation at night from the walls keeps them warm, and they see science actually in action, and it becomes unforgettable when that happens. But to do that, we take inspiration from our ancestral knowledge, reverse engineering how our ancestors built these mud fortresses and palaces 500 years ago, 2,000 years ago, and they still stand, whereas cement has a life of some 100 years. These stand all in the elements for hundreds of years and thousands. So learning from them and adding science to make it more comfortable. The whole campus has all systems run with solar energy, from cooking, greenhouses to produce vegetables, and finally even cows at the campus live in solar heated cow sheds and give 3 times more milk because the food they eat doesn't have to warm their bodies. That comes from the sun, from the shed, solar heated shed. So the food translates into milk because they don't have to keep their bodies at 37 degrees with the food. 3 years ago, we took another problem. The whole idea is to solve problems using high school science with the students. And this time it was the water crisis that Himalayan villages are facing with climate change. As glaciers are melting fast, in spring, when farmers really need water, there's very little water because it's too cold at the glaciers, and now they are getting smaller also. But then in summer, there's too much water and there are floods. And this flow continues into autumn and even winter when nobody farms, so the water goes waste. So we started refreezing that water in winter when nobody needs, so that it can last till spring when everybody needs water. But how to keep ice from winter till summer or spring. Everybody thought it was not possible because all flat ice goes away by March end. Then to our help came high school geometry. You would know from your geometry and science that some shapes have low surface area for the volume they contain, like spheres, more practically hemispheres, or even cones. So if the surface area is low, then the sun can't melt the ice or can melt it very slowly. So we experimented, did a prototype at our school to make a cone of ice, which would have the geometry, which will keep it till late into the summer and melt when farmers need water. And the prototype was built in a very, very simple way, using nothing, again, but school science. Just a pipe upstream goes taken downstream to the desert where you plant water, and because of the pipe, water wants to maintain its level, simple high school science. And due to this, there is pressure in the pipe to go to that level, and that pressure is used to run a fountain which sprays the water, winter water, into minus 20 air. And there, the water loses its latent heat, a term that tortures many students in exams but doesn't come to much use. So as it loses its latent heat, liquid becomes solid and you get a cone of ice, like a pyramid. But to build a pyramid would be a big drudgery if you were to carry blocks of ice. Here you're using fluid properties of water to go by itself and then freeze into a solid cone. So what you get is something like this. A cone, this one is like 7 stories tall, the first pilot, and the fountain makes it freeze, and this one carried roughly 1 million liters of water, which melts in May and June when everybody wants water and there is not enough water. But innovations are not just a lab engineering. Innovation has to be close to people's hearts. So therefore, we didn't want to position it as cones of ice. We thought conical is the shape, but there are other cones in the surroundings. For example, the stupas. Stupas are these conical mounds of earth or stone that are sacred to the people and therefore close to their hearts. And we thought, why not position it as an ice stupa and thereby bring it close to the people, thereby blend technology with tradition. So we called it ice stupas, therefore. And to brand it that way, like you see, stupas have prayer flags. We even put prayer flags on the first pilot. But this was more for sunshade partial and partial windbreak so that the ice lasts longer. And then we invited spiritual leaders like His Holiness Chetsang Rinpoche, who is also known for his environmental activities, to bless the stupa and promote it. So you have to collaborate with spiritual leaders, film actors, students to take care of the planet. Engineers can't solve it sitting in a laboratory. Collaboration is the essence, and engaging communities is the essence. So that's how we engaged communities. In the past,
despite seemingly insurmountable problems like broken pipes, frozen fountains, and so on. After January, the ice stupa grew to a maximum height of 64 feet, which was 11 feet taller than the current Guinness World Record for a man-made ice structure. Finally, on 5th of March 2015, the first pilot ice stupa was blessed and inaugurated by His Holiness Chetsang Rinpoche.
Sangadin,
Gets involved in science applied to issues that mountain people face, like climate change, community through all its organs.
On this occasion, roughly 1,000 people planted 5,000 trees to be irrigated by the Aistupa artificial glacier system.
So in some 3 hours, they planted 5,000 trees to prove the concept, whether these trees can survive on a total desert which has never had any greenery, only with the Aistupa, and it's been doing great for many years. Now, engaging communities in the past was for things like building stupas. Everybody in the area would contribute labor, whatever they had, wood or food. Now, in modern times, we thought this can be much bigger, and crowdfunding is another way of that kind of contribution. So to build the modern Aistupa, we went to the whole world and launched a crowdfunding campaign to fund it, and the world was very generous and overwhelmingly supportive. We surpassed our target of $119,000 with some $125,000, the first Aistupa. So it was a stupa building process as our ancestors did, but this was engaging many more people worldwide. Yeah, the monks and the Aistupas from winters, this winter it is. It was 24 meters tall, and the young students from this school who built it as volunteers posing with this mountains of ice. Normally we pray for snowfall in spring. That's the only way you would get water in spring. And snowfall can sometimes happen, sometimes not. But when you build your own glaciers, artificial glaciers, you know you have it safe. And if it snows, better even. So these are the stupas from last winter. The idea is that on the right, it shows how in winter it forms and in summer it melts. On the left side, and the melt water, the ground is so designed, goes into the tank, and from the tank, the trees are drip irrigated. So roughly 50,000 liters every day we were collecting from these Aistupas. And this is how it is structured, with a dome in the center to control the pipes. Now we are working to create ice restaurants and ice bars inside those, so that tourism can pay for the costs of farmers' water. The next journey we are embarking on is more serious. We are doing tests for this. You would know that there are dangerous glacial lakes forming in many mountains, Himalayas and Andes, and sometimes they cause big floods. So we are working on a system simply using siphon technique, again another high school science, to drain the water from the lakes with the suction without any moving parts. All these that you saw, the Aistupas or the solar-heated buildings, they don't use any electricity, no power, no moving parts, nothing can break. So similarly, using a pipe to drain the lake and refreeze it into many, many Aistupas below, as you can see. Now, if that happens, which we are now working on, then you would be re-glaciating the Himalayas, something that didn't happen since the last ice age on large scale. We are working on small models in the high Himalayas to simulate those conditions, and finally we'll put them together at a lake in Sikkim, which is very dangerous. And if that happens, we'll not only solve the disaster risk, but also engage and enlarge the Himalayan glaciers. Finally, our vision now is to again use our methods to engage community in an even wider way. With the Rolex Award last year, we started a new campaign to build an alternative university for the mountains, where solutions like these do not remain one-off things for a person or a place, but all young people can engage in such solutions as part of their education, not after education, but education should be solving problems and learning that way. So this is the desert you see. It's an 8-kilometer desert. At the top is where you saw the ice stupas forming. Slowly we'll be bringing them down and greening the whole desert into something like the right site, which is an artist's impression of the students, and to start the world's first alternative mountain university, again, crowd-funded university, with the support of all the people of the world. We have already started this crowdfunding to raise $1 million, and we're almost there. Again, this will be a university started by the people of the world, community of the world, and students, professors, senior citizens are all engaging in different ways, not just financial, but giving their skills and expertise and so on. Thank you very much. Thank you.